Okay, so let's talk about linear inequalities. So when it comes to linear inequalities, there's a few things that you need to keep in mind. So you may be asked to simply just graph one of these. And when it comes to graphing, you need to understand the direction, and you also need to understand what kind of dot you're going to have over it. You may also be asked to put this in interval notation, so we're going to talk about that as well. And you also may be asked to solve some linear inequalities where you're going to have to put all three of these together, the graphing, the interval notation, along with solving it. All right, so let's first start off with how to graph these. All right, so a lot of times when you're solving linear inequalities, you're going to be left with an answer that could look like either one of these. Right, so a lot of times you're asked to graph your solution. All right, so we need to understand how to do that first. So before that even, the difference between solving linear inequalities and solving equations, well, inequalities deal with these symbols here, right? Less than or greater than, less than or equal to, greater than equal to, right? We no longer have this situation where maybe x just equals a 3 and that's it, right? If we have an answer that states x equals 3, that means x can only equal 3 and that is it. Whereas if we have an inequality, we're now talking about a range of solutions. For example, example A here says x is less than negative 3, and that's our solution there. So that means our answer is anything that's less than 3. So that means 2.99999, that means a 0, that means a negative 10, that means there's so many different possibilities. As long as it's less than 3, it'll work for our problem here. All right, so we're no longer talking about just one single solution. We're talking about a range of solutions, and we need to understand how to note that. All right, so there's two things that you need to be concerned with when it comes to just graphing. So first off, when I'm asked to graph, so I'm going to draw my number line here. All right, and I typically am just concerned with the numbers that the actual problem is asking me to graph. So here it's talking about a 3. I'm just going to draw a 3 on my graph. Do understand, of course, your positive numbers are to the right, your negative numbers are to the left. So the two things that you need to be concerned with is what direction are you shading and what kind of dot are you drawing. So you have two possibilities as far as your dot. You can either have an open dot or you can have a solid dot. The difference between the two. So an open dot means that that particular number that you're drawing the dot on top is not part of your solution. So for example here, x is less than 3. Now that means x has to be less than 3. It cannot equal 3, right? So I don't want it to actually equal 3, so I'm going to circle the 3. I'm leaving it open because it's not, can't actually be 3, but it could be everything less than 3. Everything less than 3 is everything to the left, all the negative numbers. So I would shade then to the left, right? So the direction you're shading is typically the direction the arrow is pointing in for the most part, unless you're talking about some of these three-part inequalities here. And the type of dot just depends on the symbol. If you're dealing with less than or greater than, that's going to be an open dot. Less than or equal to, greater than or equal to has a solid dot. Okay, so that's what the difference between the two means. The open dot means it doesn't actually equal that number. The solid dot means it does include it. All right, so taking a look at example B, x is greater than or equal to negative 1. So I'm going to draw my number line. Here's a negative 1. First, look at the symbol. So here I have a greater than or equal to symbol, which means it can include the negative 1. Right, this says that it is greater than it or equal to it, so I am going to include the negative 1. I want everything greater than it, so that means everything to the right of it. So for this one here, we would be shading to the right. C is a three-part inequality here, so I'm going to draw my number line here, and we're concerned with negative 1 and with 3. All right, so this says, all right, so a lot of times when it comes to the three-part inequalities here, sometimes it's good to cover up the sides here. This says x is less than or equal to 3, right? So I do have the less than or equal than symbol, so that means I'm going to have a solid dot where the 3 is concerned. Over here where the negative 1 is, that's just the less than symbol, so that's going to be open there. So also, for the most part, when it does come to these three-part inequalities, you typically have two options when it comes to the shading. You're either going to be shading between them, or you're going to be shading on the outsides of them. Right? So for this one here, it says x is less than or equal to the 3. Alright, which means I'm going to be shading to the left of the 3 here. So typically that means I'm going to be shading inside here. This also says that x is greater than negative 1. So if it's greater than negative 1, that means it has to be the right of negative 1. Alright, so always cover up one side of the inequality so you can read this part. Now we are used to reading an inequality from left to right. We're used to the x being on the left-hand side. So when we covered up the right-hand side here, if this part confused you, the negative 1 is less than x, so that means negative 1 is smaller than x. So because it's smaller than x, right, it would be to the left over here. We're not including it. Whereas this, reading it from the right-hand side, it says x is greater than negative 1. Remember, the pointy end is always to the smaller number. The open end is always to the bigger number. If this type of notation does confuse you, do keep in mind you can take this inequality and you can flip it to where the x is on the right-hand side. Literally think about, you know, with this inequality like this, flip it totally over. Right? So if I wanted to rewrite this with the x on the left-hand side, it would look like this. The open end is still to the x. The pointy end is still to the negative 1. So here x is greater than negative 1. So I want everything to the right of negative 1. So that's what those graphs would look like with this here. So talking about interval notation, so I'm just going to take these same examples and we're going to write them in interval notation, starting with x is less than 3. All right, so interval notation, so it's just another way to draw or to write your solution. So typically when it does come, anything dealing with graphs and actually writing out your solution, you want to look at your graphs from left to right. Right, so it's kind of, it looks very similar to an ordered pair. If you're familiar with graphing and that type of thing, it might be ringing bells and something like that. But do understand this is a little bit different. This is not an ordered pair. This is not a solution point. This is just a range of answers. Your answers are from what point to what point is what this is telling you here. Okay, so the things that you need to pay attention to when it comes to writing the interval notation is you need to know what to plug in for your endpoints, and then you also need to know, are you drawing parentheses or are you drawing brackets? So the difference between the parentheses and the brackets is the same thing with the open dot and the solid dot. Open dot means it doesn't include that number. Solid dot means it does. So parentheses means it doesn't include that number. The bracket means it would. Right, so again, those are based off of your symbols. If you have the less than or greater than, you're dealing with parentheses. If you have the equal to symbols with it, then you're dealing with the brackets. Otherwise, you're just scanning from left to right. Also, these inequalities here, these have ranges of answers. Do keep in mind when this arrow keeps going all the way to the left, or this one over here keeps going all the way to the right, it doesn't stop. It keeps going and it keeps going. So if it keeps going to the left in the negative direction, that's known as negative infinity. If it keeps going off into the right direction, well, that's positive infinity. So when I'm looking at this graph here and trying to put it into interval notation, okay, I need my leftmost number and my rightmost number. My leftmost number, well, if you get my graph from left to right, this goes off until negative infinity. So negative infinity is my leftmost number. And then it goes, and it stops at 3. Okay, so my solutions are from negative infinity to 3. Then I need to be concerned with, do I have parentheses or brackets? Well, I have the less than symbol, that means parentheses. Anytime you ever have an infinity, whether it's negative infinity or positive infinity, that's always going to be parentheses. Right? So there's always a parentheses around infinity. This 3 is an open dot, which means parentheses. So parentheses, negative infinity, all the way to 3. For this one over here, example B, So looking from left to right, my solutions don't start until negative one. So that's where they start, negative one, and they go all the way until infinity. On the left-hand side, that is a solid dot, and a solid dot is a bracket. On the right-hand side, I have an infinity is a parentheses. You could have different types of parentheses, brackets, depending on what side you're talking about. So on the left-hand side, we have a bracket. The right-hand side, we have a parentheses. Over here, this bottom example, so our solutions go from negative one, and then they go until I hit three, and that's it. The negative one has an open dot, so that means parentheses. The three has a solid dot, that means brackets. Okay, so that's the interval notation. So typically when you solve a linear inequality, a lot of times you have to graph it and then put it in interval notation as well. Okay, so let's go over a couple of examples and actually solving linear inequalities. So example A over here. Actually, before I even get started with that, so the one thing that we want to keep in mind when it comes to solving linear inequalities, it's pretty much the same thing as solving an equation. The only difference is this, that if you multiply or divide by a negative number, you must flip the inequality symbol. Because think about what happens when you multiply or divide by a negative, right? If you multiply by a negative or divide by a negative, that changes the sign. Right, so if I was looking at positive answers over here, but now I multiplied by a negative, so my sign changed, well, I totally need to flip over, well, hey, now my answers are negative. So you need to flip to the other side when your sign changes like that. So that happens when you multiply or divide by a negative. Otherwise, all the steps of solving an equation stand for these inequalities, so everything else is the same. So taking a look at example A, right, we're solving for x here, so we need to get that all by itself. I do see I have one on either side. Same thing with my numbers. I'm going to work on getting x to the left-hand side. So I'm going to take this 7x and move it over here. That's a positive 7x, so I'm going to subtract it. That's going to cancel on the right-hand side, so I'm going to drop down that negative 4. On the left-hand side, we had 8x. We're subtracting 7x, so that's going to be 1x. And drop down this minus 2. All right, the only thing left really to finish this off is to get this negative 2 and move it to the right-hand side. So since it's a negative 2, I'm going to do the opposite and add 2 to both sides. That'll cancel, and we get that x is greater than or equal to a negative 2. Right here we have a negative 4 plus 2, which is a negative 2. So here we do need to solve and graph. So this is what our solution would be. X is anything greater than or equal to a negative 2. So the graph for this would look like, well, we're concerned with negative 2 there, right? First, pay attention, what kind of dot? So here we have a greater than or equal to symbol. If it has the equal to symbol on it, that means it is a solid dot. And we want everything greater than negative 2, which means we want everything to the right. Okay. All right, moving over to this one here. So this one's a one-step problem here. We have negative 3x is less than 21, right? So we have that negative 3x, which is the same thing as negative 3 times x. So we do the opposite and we divide. So I'm going to divide both sides by negative 3. On the left-hand side, negative 3 divided by negative 3 cancels, and I'm going to drop down the x. On the right-hand side, 21 divided by negative 3. Well, first off, that's different signs, so it's negative. 21 divided by 3 is 7. Also, do be aware we are using this property here. We did divide by a negative, so that means this is no longer a less than. This is now a greater than. So our solution here is x is greater than negative 7. Okay, so our graph would look like, I'm going to go ahead and plot the negative 7 on here. Taking a look at our inequality symbol, that's a greater than symbol, which means it would be an open dot. Otherwise, I want everything greater than negative 7, so that means I want everything to the right of negative 7.